So let me start by thanking the organizers, of course, for including our paper in the program. It's a great pleasure to present it here in front of this audience. So this is joint work with my colleagues, Gara Afonso and President John Williams, and our former colleague, Domenico Giannone, who's now at Amazon. The usual disclaimer applies. These are our own personal views. They do not necessarily reflect the view of the New York Fed or the Federal Reserve System at large or the FOMC. So the paper, of course, is about banks' demand for reserves. And let me begin by giving an exact definition of what we are after. So we're after the reserve demand curve, which is the price at which banks are willing to lend reserves with each other as a function of the aggregate reserves in the banking system. Now, as everybody knows, probably, this is a key monetary policy object, and for two reasons. The first reason is that the FOMC, when it communicates its monetary policy stance, it does so by specifying a range for the rates at which reserves are lent in the market for reserves. And the second reason is that the Fed can indeed affect and change the level of aggregate reserves in the system, but it's not the only one that can do that. Other factors outside the Fed's control can also affect the level of aggregate reserves in the system. So it becomes extremely important for monetary policy implementation to get a sense, hopefully in real time, of where you are sitting on the curve, and in particular, what the slope is. Because the slope tells you the sensitivity of rates, the rates that you are targeting as a monetary authority to reserve shocks. So that begs the question, can we have a well-identified high frequency, and when I say high frequency here, I mean daily estimate of this demand curve and its slope? But that's exactly what we try to do with this paper. So we try to structurally estimate the reserve demand curve at daily frequency for a long time period, a long stretch of time, that goes from 2010 to mid-2021. So basically, it encompasses the whole post-great financial crisis period. Now, there are two challenges here for this exercise. The first one is obvious. There are endogeneity issues that are typical of any demand estimation. Here, I'm thinking about supply versus demand shocks, or more generally, any form of omitted variable bias. But there's another challenge that is specific to what we are trying to do in our object of interest, which has to do with the fact that there have been several structural changes in the banking industry, in particular in the market for reserves in the post-crisis period. And here I have in mind regulatory, supervisory changes, but also internal changes coming from the banking sector to the post-crisis environment. And these changes may have moved the curve over time. So that creates a further identification problem. So how do we deal with this? So what we do, we develop a time-varying structural model of the demand curve, and we apply it to daily data. So you can think of our approach as having two components. The first component is we propose a very flexible forecasting model of the joint dynamics of rates and reserves at the daily frequency. I will be more specific in a few slides, but basically we are using a time-varying vector autoregressive model at the daily frequency with stochastic volatility. Then we combine the forecasting model with an IV approach, an instrumental variable approach. And specifically, we use forecast errors for the path of reserves 5 days ago as an instrument for today's aggregate reserves in our structural demand equation. And I want to emphasize right away that using daily data is actually key for this exercise because it buys you a lot of identification power. And without daily data, you wouldn't be able to do most of the things that you do. So let me give a preview of our results right away. So in the top figure, I'm just showing the time series of our main data. So prices and quantities. So rates at which reserves are lent and aggregate reserves. So on the x-axis, you have time from 2010 to mid-2021. The solid line represents aggregate reserves normalized by banks' total assets to account for the growth in the banking industry over time. Consider we are looking at 12 years of time. So this is important. And the y scale is the dashed line instead is the rate, the average rate at which reserves are lent in the Fed funds market, in the market for reserves, minus the interest on reserve balances paid by the Fed. So we are controlling for the monetary policy stance because changes in this administered rate, I would be more specific in a heartbeat, but the changes in monetary policy would mechanically shift the curve up and down, contaminating our results. But just think about prices and quantities, and it's color-coded. So dark blue is the beginning of our sample, 2010, then it gets lighter. We have gray in the middle of the sample, 2013, 2014 until 2017. Then light pink for 2018, it gets darker 2019, and red for 2020 and 2021. And the first thing you can see from the top panel is that there is already a nice negative relationship between these two quantities that suggest that it's feasible to estimate a demand curve over time given a high frequency. But what I want you to focus on, of course, is the bottom part, which is our result, our main result. So in that figure, I'm plotting our model implied forecast for the reserve demand curve and comparing it with the data realizations. So our in-sample forecast 5 days ahead are the points, and the data realizations are the squares. So quantities on the x-axis, so reserves normalized by assets, and spreads, so and rates controlling for monetary policy on the y-axis prices. And this figure is telling us basically three things. First, the model works well because points and squares very nicely align with each other, extremely good. Secondly, the model is able to capture the classic downward sloping feature of any demand curve, but not only, it's also able to capture the nonlinearity predicted by the theory. So later on in my slides, I will tell a bit about the theory. We'll talk a bit about the theory. But as you see, we have a negative slope until reserves reach a point after which the slope flattens out. And that's predicted by the theory. But the most important thing that this graph is telling us is that the curve actually indeed moved over time, and there have been shifts over time, at least two shifts. So if we move down the curve in 2010, as reserves started to increase, we go down, the slope starts to decrease, then it gets flatter after after aggregate reserves crosses roughly 12-13% of banks total assets. We reach in 2015 the peak of aggregate reserves of the system. And as we move down now, as the Fed started to normalize its balance sheet after 2015, then we retrace back the curve. We reobserve in 2018 a negative slope, but the curve is now above the peak. So there's been a first shift between 2010 and 2018, 2019. And there's been a further shift, you see the dark red dots, after March 2020, at the onset of the COVID outbreak. So here are the results. The reserve demand curve has shifted over time outward. There was a further move outward after COVID crisis. In terms of its slope, it was flat during 2012, 2017, and it becomes flat again after March 2020. And this is the region that people have referred to as the region of abundant reserves. Reserves are so plentiful that rates do not respond even to relatively sizable shocks. But we do observe a negative slope at the beginning of our sample, 2010 and 2011, and in 2018, 2019. Although aggregate reserves and levels were way above 1 trillion, which many people found surprising. The slope is there, it's very significant, but it's still more gentle than what people used to observe in the 90s. There is a very influential paper by Hamilton, AR, 1997, which he repeats a similar exercise. And that was the region of scarce reserves. Finally, the region in which we observe a transition from flat to sloped is about 12% of banks' total assets in terms of reserves. So here is how I will proceed. So I will spend a long time on the institutional background because it turns out to be key to properly estimate the reserve demand, so the exercise we are doing. Then I will talk about the model, the identification strategy, so how we deal with endogeneity, what type of endogeneity we are dealing with. If I had time, I would go over a very long out-of-sample forecast evaluation exercise, but I won't have time, so you can find it in the appendix of the paper. And because I want to move on to the economics and our business, which will be the closing part of the presentation. So let me start with aggregate reserves and their evolution over time. So what are reserves? Reserves are deposits held by banks. And when I say banks, I mean depository institution, I'm being, okay? Held by banks at the Federal Reserve. Now, this figure here is showing their variation over time from roughly 2005 until 2021. And this figure is very powerful because it's conveying a very important message in my opinion. So it's telling us, so the dashed line, you see vertical dashed line is around September 2008. So it's when they at the height of the great financial crisis. So this figure is telling us that when you look at the dynamics, when you think of the dynamics of aggregate reserves, there was a pre-crisis and a post-crisis. And the two dynamics are completely different. So before the financial crisis, reserves were living in the realm of tens of billions. After the financial crisis, when the Fed response put in place several programs expanding its balance sheet to stabilize the economy and financial stability, then reserves jumped to trillions, so two orders of magnitude, and so their volatility also. But let's talk about how actually reserves change over time, mechanically. And here I need a bit of a hand. So from the bank's perspective, reserves are assets. From the Fed's perspective, though, they are liabilities. So there are two ways that reserves, aggregate reserves in the banking system can change. The first one is quite obvious. If the Fed expands and contracts its balance sheet, so by changing the size of its balance sheet, right, for example, by purchasing assets from the banking sector, it also creates or destroys reserves. Because when it purchases assets from the banking sector, the asset side of its balance sheet expands, but it also credits the banks to the reserve account. So you have an identical increase in reserves. But there is another way in which reserves can change, of course, holding the size of the balance sheet of the Fed fixed, there may be a recomposition of the Fed's liabilities. So a non-reserve liability may decrease, and mechanical reserve, aggregate reserves, must increase. And the reason why this is happening is because reserves are not a closed system. Banks every day transact with other holders of Fed accounts that are not reserves, though. They are not considered reserves. And I want to give two very important examples. One is the U.S. Treasury. The U.S. Treasury has an account at the Fed. It's called the TGA, the Treasury General Account. And when banks purchase at each one's Treasury securities, the way they pay the Treasury back is through their reserves. So there is a transfer from their reserves to the TGA, which means a decrease in aggregate reserves in the system and an identical increase in the TGA account, is not reserve liability. Same thing happens with tax payments when banks submit payments on behalf of their clients. The other non-reserve liability that I want to emphasize, that I want you to focus on, is the overnight reverse repo facility or overnight RRP. So through this facility, money market funds, which by the way are the main wholesale lenders of banks, they can place cash at the Fed by investing in basically reverse repos collateralized by treasuries, okay, at a fixed rate. But mechanically, the way they do it, they instruct their custodian banks to make the cash transfer. And when the custodian banks do that, they're using their reserves. So for each dollar invested by money funds in the overnight RRP, there is a $1 decrease in aggregate reserves because mechanically the cash is coming from the custodian bank's account, so their reserves. So why am I talking about non-reserve liabilities? I mean, if they were small, or even if they were big but stable, they wouldn't matter probably. But it turns out that they're neither small nor their dynamics is stable. So here at the top, the figure at the top is just showing the ratio of non-reserves liabilities, excluding currency, okay? So the real active non-reserve liabilities over the total amount of reserves in the system. And as you can see, over time, from 2010 to mid-2021, our time period. So first of all, they are sizable. They started at roughly 40% in 2010, 2011. Then they went down to 20% in 2012. And then they started increasing steadily throughout 2015, 17, 18. And they reached more than 80% in March 2020. And not only they increased, there is also a lot of volatility in their shape, so their dynamic is very rich. And here at the bottom, I'm just showing you the two cases that I gave you before because I think they're very emblematic and important. We have the TGA on the left, so the Treasury account, and it was hovering around 100 billion at the beginning of our sample, started to increase sizably after 2015 with some volatility though. And in response to the March 2020 crisis, it picked more than $1.5 trillion. That's more than 30% of the aggregate reserves in the system. On the right, we have the overnight RRP, which did not even exist before 2013, but then its usage exploded between 2014 to 2018 with peaks of more than 400 billion per day. And it came back again during the COVID crisis in March 2020, you can see a bit there. And now it's even larger. And last time I checked, it's way above 1 trillion, it was a few months ago. So they're important and their dynamics is very rich. Now, let me talk about the Fed funds market, so the market in which reserves are traded among banks. So it's unsecured lending, mainly overnight, and the Fed funds rates, which are the lending rates of reserves in this market, are the rates targeted by the Fed in its implementation monetary policy. So we target a range for the bulk of these rates. Now, what does the theory tell us then about the demand curve? Okay. So absent frictions, Fed funds rates should always be above the interest paid by the Fed on reserve balances. So a bank have an account at the Fed, they have reserves, and they're paid an interest, okay? So notice that before 2008, that was identically zero because the reserves were not remunerated. But in general, Fed funds rates should always be above the opportunity cost of holding reserves. Why should I land reserves are a rate that is lower than the rate that I'm earning if I just keep them sitting in my account. And they should always be below the discount window rate, which is the rate at which banks borrow from the Fed, because they have no incentive to borrow from another bank at a rate that is higher than the rate that I would get from. Absent frictions, I won't enter into the frictions, but there are, so there are deviations, but they're not interesting for what we do. So the theory tells us about the reserve demand curve, and it's bounded from above by discount window rate, from below from by interest on reserves. And there are two regions. There is a region in which the curve is steep, and it's the region called the scarce reserves. And that's usually around aggregate reserve requirements. So the theory predicts that around aggregate reserve requirements, the slope of the curve is very steep because banks pay a very high cost in going in overdraft, okay, and not meeting the requirement at the end of each year. Then as reserves expand away from aggregate reserves, the curve becomes flat. And that's the region that has been called, referred to, the region of abundant reserves. Reserves are so plentiful that even sizable shocks to the aggregate reserves do not materially affect rates. So what's in between the two then? And here it depends on the model. Old models without trading frictions derive a piecewise linear function, so there's a king. More modern models with trading frictions, very start trading frictions, actually derive a smooth, gentle slope, in which rates do respond, so it's not perfectly flat, but it's not as steep as the curve in the scarce region. So to motivate further the work, let me talk a bit about monetary policy implementation then. So why does this thing matter? And let's start with scarce reserves. Was the environment before the 2008 crisis. So reserves were in the tens of billions, they were not really rated. So banks had very strong incentive to actively trade every day. And the slope of the demand curve was very steep. So how could the Fed hit the target? What is it? Even small adjustment to the reserve supply that the Fed can control would move the price materially and would allow the Fed to hit the equilibrium rate that it was targeting. How do you do it, however, if reserves are abundant? So we are now in the post-crisis period, reserves are in the trillions, and they are remunerated, but the incentive to trade actively is lower. They're already earning something. And then, even if you move the supply of reserves by a sizable amount, you may not be able to reach the target rate because the curve is practically flat. So while you have to change the framework, and you move to a floor framework, that's how it's called, in which instead of moving the reserve supply every day to daily open market operations, as it was the case before the crisis, you change the administered rates. So the Fed is administering the interest on reserve balances and the discount window rate. So by changing them, you're changing the opportunity cost of holding reserves, and you're shifting the curve up and down vertically to make sure that you can hit the target rate or have rates being within the range, to be precise. So that's how we actually do it. So this is already telling you why, when we estimate the reserve demand curve, we have to control for monetary policy changes and changes in the interest on reserve balances. We don't want to contaminate our estimate with these vertical shifts that are just due to the monetary policy stance. Okay, before I get to the model, I want to talk about the drivers of the movements in the reserve demand curve that people have put forward over the last years. So the academic literature, central bankers, and the industry publications, they pointed to several drivers, factors that could have pushed the reserve demand curve upward. So it could have increased the precautionary demand of banks for reserves in the post-great financial crisis environment. So one of these items is the new regulatory supervisory framework. So things like liquidity coverage ratio, living wings, so resolution plans, supervisory stress tests, they all increase the demand for very safe and very liquid assets, such as reserves. But even letting alone the regulator and the supervisor, banks themselves have changed their own internal liquidity risk management procedures. And nowadays, they have a strong preference for extremely safe and liquid assets, and in particular, for reserves, even compared to other safe assets, such as treasuries. But that's not the whole story. So it's not about just a search for safety and liquidity due to the experience of the crisis themselves and risks that they realize. There's also, there's been a structural change in how the market for reserves functions, okay? It has become, in a sense, atrophic. So in terms of liquidity measured as volume of liquidity, it has decreased massively. So there is a lack of late day funding market in the reserve market, lack of late day volume. Okay? So this combined with large underrating that banks need to submit, of course, increase the precautionary demands. So these are the three main themes that people have put forward to justify or to conjecture an increase in the reserve. Okay, some upward pressure. Let me get to the model now and our identification function. So we start by postulating that the reserve demand curve follows at the daily frequency the structural equation that you see at the top of this slide. Okay. So on the left hand side, you have prices. So here is the weighted average Fed funds rate, so the weighted average rate at which reserves are lent in the market, minus the IRB, so the interest on reserve balances. On the right hand side, you have quantities. So those are reserves normalized by banks' total assets to control for the growth in the industry, as we control for monetary policy when we control prices. We also want to control for the sizable growth in the banking industry over time, over our 12 years. Now, what is key is that all the parameters in the model, so the intercept alpha, the slope beta, and also the variance of the structural error are time varying. So what's the idea behind what we're doing here? So instead of estimating a non-linear function, whose estimation may be fragile and hard to pin down, we use a very flexible linear model with time-varying coefficients and stochastic volatility to capture the nominal. Of course, there is an assumption behind this, which is the structural parameters that evolve, that determine the evolution of the demand curve over time. They move more slowly than the liquidity shocks that banks face every day. And the rationale is that it took banks months or even years to adjust to the post-crisis framework. So this is a very plausible assumption in our mind. So of course, the object of interest is the time-varying slope, beta, which measures the elasticity of rates to reserve shocks. So let me talk about endogeneity and the types of endogeneity that we're facing when we try to estimate this function. So the first type of endogeneity is quite obvious and is kind of similar to the endogeneity issues that econometricians face in the 90s when trying to estimate reserve. However, in today's world, the Fed does not implement monetary policy for daily open market operations. But it still does respond to unusual dislocations in the Fed funds market to keep control, to maintain control over the targeted rates. So we do not react every, the Fed does not react every day, but in some special circumstances, it does respond to unusual dislocations. And the clear example here is what happened in mid-September 2020, when unsecured funding rates spiked up, so Fed funds and repo rates spiked up. On September 17th, the effective federal funds rate reached the target range, and over the following days, the Fed responded by expanding the reserve supply through repo operations in the market. And soon after that, almost immediately, both secured and unsecured rates returned to the prior level. So there is an endogeneity issue because the Fed responds to these locations, basically in the demand curve, shocks to the demand curve. The key thing for us is that when you look at things at a sufficiently high frequency, there is a delay. The second type of endogeneity is more subtle, and that's the reason why I spend a long time on non-reserve liabilities and their role. So not only they change the level mechanically, perspective of aggregate reserves in the system, but they can also correlate with the demand shocks in reserve demand. And why is that? Because the holders of these non-reserve accounts are key money market participants. So think about the treasury that is issuing treasuries, of course, which are among the most sought after money market instruments, but are also collateral for overnight repo transactions. Actually, they are most used collateral. Money market funds are the largest wholesale lender to banks and the most important lender in the repo market. Federal home loan banks, they also have no reserve accounts at the Fed, and they both lend in the repo market, and they can also lend in the Fed funds market through their accounts. So their actions, and therefore the variability in their no reserve liabilities, both affect and depend on reserve demand for short-term overnight funding. The classic example, again, is the repo market dynamics. It not only can spill over onto the Fed funds market, as it happened in September, but its dynamics depends and correlates with the non-reserve liabilities, like overnight RRP and TGA, of these holders of non-reserve accounts. There is an interesting growing literature on the role of non-reserve liabilities, both in the demand for reserves and in the demand for repo funding. I won't have time to discuss it, but I encourage everybody to take a look. So let me be a bit more specific though, and let me give you a few examples of endogeneity. So around month ends, European banks shrink their wholesale short-term borrowing to improve their regulatory capital ratio. The reason is that by regulation, their capital ratios are calculated as a snapshot at the end of the month. So when they do that, their demand for reserves or their demand for borrowing in the Fed funds markets decreases. At the same time, they also borrow less from money market funds, which are the main lender. So what do money market funds do? Well, with the extra cash, they place it at the overnight RP, causing a further decrease in reserves. Now, the good, so it moves both with the demand shocks and with the level of resources. The good thing about this endogeneity is that it's also quite high frequency. So if you have good high frequency data, you can control it. Let me give another example, which is treasury options. So on settlement dates, when banks purchase treasuries, their demand for overnight funding increases because that's how they finance the purchase. So this puts upward pressure in the reserve demand curve on the one end. And on the other end, though, to pay for the treasuries, they make a transfer from their reserves account to the GGA, which causes a mechanic decrease in the level of reserves in the system. So this is important because these transactions, these between reserve and non-reserve account holders, happen frequently. The good thing, though, is that they are short-lived, they're quite high frequency. And you can trust me, around corporate tax payments, a very similar dynamic take place. So how do we deal with the endogeneity then? But first of all, we clean the data and we drop 1 day windows around month ends to take care of the window dressing campaigns. So that's the first reason why the data are key. And then we have a more general approach, which is design instrumental variable approach with two components. First, the forecasting model of the joint dynamics of prices and quantity, okay, so rates and reserves. And as I said before, we are basically using a daily time varying VR with stochastic volatility based on Primicheri 2005. And the assumption, of course, as before, is that the model parameters move more slowly than the daily errors. And so these are slow moving runoff. Then we use the forecast errors, fast forecast errors for the reserves path as instruments for aggregate reserves in our structural. Let me give you a bit more details here. So we estimate the VR and we obtain forecast errors. Then we use for reserves. Then we use the forecast error for reserves H days before as an instrument for aggregate reserves Q in our structural equation. So then you can easily write the IV estimate of the ratio of two covariances, the covariance of prices with the forecast error for reserves by H days before, over the covariance of reserves themselves with their own forecast error H days before. Of course, since the model everything is time varying here, we allow these covariances to be time varying. But instead of using, so typically people when do AV, they use two-stage least squares, we take a different route. We pull back these covariances directly from the estimation of the reduced form VR. So, you know, that we, which allows the representation, as you know. So we can take the Q, project them on the series of forecast errors on reserves. We can do the same with S. The loadings on each forecast error for this projection are the impulse response functions. So on the left here, we have the series for the Q. So Psi QQ is the impulse response function of reserves for reserve shock, and Psi is Q on the right for the projection that defines the series of prices. That's the impulse response function of prices for reserve shock, of rates for reserve shock. Of course, there are residuals here, Q tilde and S tilde, which are the similar linear combinations of forecast errors for the series of rates. But the way we estimate our VR is such that forecast errors for rates are residualized with respect forecast errors for reserves, so that their correlation contemporaneously is mechanically zero. And from that follows that our IV estimate can be simply written as a ratio of impulse response functions of rates to reserve shocks over impulse response function of reserves to reserve shocks at horizon H. Now, the first impulse response function, if you want to think in terms of IV, traditional frequentist IV, it would be the reduced form regression, and the denominator would be the first stage regression. So since we're talking about IV, we have to address exogeneity and relevance. So first of all, let me tell you that we take H equal to 5. So we use forecast error from 5 days before, so 1 week of lag. So the exclusion restriction is that this 5 days ago forecast error is uncorrelated with the structural error. Obviously, there is a sufficient condition, which is no contemporaneous correlation between reserves and the structural error. But of course, our model is more general than that. The necessary condition is that any confounding factor has transitory effects that disappear within a week. Okay. So now let me justify the exogeneity of our history. Let me start by using the sufficient condition. So if any form of endogeneity were only caused by the Fed's intervention, okay, so its response to dislocations in the Fed funds market, then that already satisfies the sufficient condition because, as we said, nowadays the Fed doesn't implement monetary policy through the open market operations. It only responds to rare events of unusual dislocation in the Fed funds market. And when it does so, it typically does it with a delay, but it's one day. So this, again, highlights the importance of daily data to estimate the model and construct forecast errors. Remember, we're looking for forecast errors by this prior. But then, even if we think about all what I described on non-reserve liabilities and the endogeneity that they induce in the model, well, the effect of those compounding factors typically lasts less than 5 business days. And think again about treasury auctions and tax payments. These events are short-lived. So it's arguably exogenous, this instrument. Is it relevant? Yes, it's actually very relevant. And that's due to the fact that the persistence of the reserves path in our sample is very high. So it's a very persistent path. And it's due to the fact that the expansions and contractions of Fed's balance sheet took months to be fully realized. And on the other end, our model has a very good forecasting accuracy. So it's the combination of these two things, a very persistent series and a good out-of-sample real-time forecasting accuracy of our model, which with its autoregressive nature can capture the monthly trends in the expansion and contraction of the Fed's balance sheet. If you want to look at that, you just look at the impulse response function of reserves to reserve shocks 5 days ahead, which is practically the equivalent of the first stage regression in the traditional LVC setting. And it's significant for our sample. So what are the advantages of our model, of our estimation methodology? Well, first of all, inference is automatically robust to weak instruments in contrast to two-stage least squares. And the reason is simple. This is a Bayesian estimation, and the posterior for our elasticity time varying slope beta already reflects uncertainty about the IRFs, the denominator of the ID estimate. So we should not be concerned about our point estimate going to zero, which is a classic problem with weak instruments. And point estimate at the denominator. They are also robust to autocorrelation and elasticity structural demand errors. And that's due to the fact that these RFs are estimated from a VR with 10 lags and stochastic volatility. And finally, we run some robustness checks also to enhance identification of our methodology. And what we do, we augment the forecasting model, including other series that have been considered as possible confounding factors in the estimation of the demand curve. And here I have in mind repo rates, T-bill rates, money market funds rates. So we use a trivariate time-varying VR model to generate the forecast so that we can directly control for this compound. Results are practically identical. So let me talk about the results and let me check. Okay, I think. So the first result, there have been shifts in the reserve demand. So here I'm plotting in the top figure, it's the in-sample forecast 5 days ahead from our model for the reserve demand curve. So on the x-axis, you have normalized reserves, so total reserves divided by bank's total assets. And on the y-axis, you have weighted average Fed funds rates minus interest on reserve balances to control for monetary policy. So at the top, you have in-sample estimates. At the bottom, you have our out-of-sample forecast 5 days ahead. So the first thing to notice is that they are remarkably similar, which actually speaks to the predictive accuracy of our model, our forecasting model. So it works well in real time. Then we have clear shifts in the demand curve, and we have two clear shifts. So we have a shift, let's say, around from during the 2010-2019 period. You see there is that negative slope in the blue dots. Then it flattens out, that's the period of flat, which is a flat curve, the gray points. And then when we come back, the curve is above the curve described by the pink points, 2018 and 2019. But then there's been a further shift post-March 2020. So the first shift that happened during 2010-2019 is consistent with these drivers due to the new regulatory supervisory framework, banks' internal liquidity risk management, pushing the curve up because they increased their precautionary demand for reserves in a permanent. A second shift is consistent with a flight to safe games due to the COVID crisis. Now, let me move to our object of interest. So the time-varying slope of the curve, so this time-varying elasticity of rates to reserve shocks. So here I'm plotting our in-sample estimate, IDE, for the elasticity of rates to shocks in normalized reserves over time. So the solid blue line is the median, the posterior median. And then you have the shaded areas that correspond to the 68% and 95% credible sets. So what comes out of this is that the slope was significantly negative at the beginning of our sample in 2010, 2011. Then it was zero, practically zero, throughout those 6 years from 2012, basically, until 2017, early 2018. Then the slope started to emerge again in early 2018 and 2019. And it disappeared, and that was the period in which the Fed started reducing its balance sheet through its normalization process. And then it disappears again as soon as the Fed expands its balance sheet in response to the COVID crisis. Now, not only it's negative in those two time periods, but it's also economically important. So if you think about it, it's very simple terms, one standard deviation in the level of reserves dollar value actually explains roughly more than 30% of in-sample variation of the rates in 2010, 2011, and more than 20% of the variation in 2018, 2019. So this slope is economically important, although much smaller than the slope estimated by Hamilton in the 90s.
Gabriele, just to point to you that you have 4 minutes, about 4 minutes left.
I'm done.
Perfect.
So, thank you. So as I said, we ran robustness checks. And we ran several robust checks, changing the horizon forecast error and augmenting the forecasting point. So here I'm showing you a version of our IDE estimate when the forecasts are generated by through our forecasting model is a trivariate VR and varying stochastic volatility. And the third series, so we have Fed funds rates, reserves, and repo rates to control for possible spillovers from the repo markets that may also correlate with changes in the non-reserve accounts of non-reserve holders like overnight or POTGA. Results are practically identical. They're very similar. We observed the same shape. Elasticity was significant in 2010, 2011, and started being significant starting from 2012, and then re-emerged again in 2018, 2019. You obtain the same result if you control for T-bill yields or for money market funding. So now let me get to the last point that I want to convey to you, which is probably the most important point from the point of view of implementing monetary policy. So where does the KIM, using the terminology of the old theoretical models, occur? You remember the transition between flat and scarce, or the region in between. So here I'm showing what I showed you before at the bottom, that's the elasticity, in sample elasticity, our IDE estimate. With the only difference now that there are these vertical dashed red lines that correspond to the points in which the 95% credible set crosses zero. So in a frequency sense, it becomes statistically insignificant, okay? Or significant, depending on which direction. And as you can see, the point in which the elasticity starts becoming negative and significantly negative is around 12%. It's a bit below 12% of banks' assets. So when reserves are slightly below 12% of banks' total assets in 2011, and slightly above 12% of banks' total assets in 2018. But it's roughly seen, around that. However, when you think in terms of the level of reserves in dollar value, this is a completely different number, exactly because you need to account for the growth of the banking sector. So the number was 1.6 trillion in 2011 and above 2 trillion in 2019. Which is what probably caught many people by surprise. So let me conclude. So in this paper, we provide a structural time varying estimation of the reserve demand curve for the post-crisis period. I think this is the first paper to do that. We consider a long stretch of time, 2010, mid-2021, which encompasses several structural changes and the recent COVID crisis. The idea behind the paper is to combine a forecasting approach using a stochastic volatility time varying VAR, an IV approach at the daily frequency. And using daily data is key for the exercise that we're trying to do here because it allows you to control for all endogeneity issues that can affect this exercise. I didn't show you, but the forecasting model has very good out-of-sample real-time performance. Again, you can refer to the appendix of the paper to look at it. What are the economic results of the paper? The reserve demand curve, as several people have conjectured, has moved upward over this time period, so it has increased, and it's slow when you look at it, changes significantly over time. So there was a negative slope already in 2018, 2019, as reserves fell below 2 trillion, which seems to be a very big number. And the region around which this negative slope starts to emerge seems to be around 12% of banks' assets, both in the most recent year that we look at the beginning of our sample in 2020. So I think I'm done. Thank you very much. And we are all very much looking forward to the feedback, because this is also the first time we present this paper. So feedback and comments are way more than welcome.
Okay, thank you very much, Gabriele. Great presentation. And I might say that I really learned a lot by reading your paper. So it was very, very interesting. So the floor is open to questions for Gabriele. Do not hesitate to open your mic and ask questions. Otherwise, I can start with a very simple question.
Barbara Rossi has some questions.
Sorry? In the chat.
I think Barbara Rossi has a question in the chat. Okay. Barbara, would you like to ask that?
Oh, yeah, sure.
Yeah, I saw that. It's a
sure, thing. Sure. Sorry. Yes, I'm also happy to ask it later if any one of you has additional questions. Anyway, so a first question was that I recall that there is a paper by Bernanke and Myhov who have a model of the Fed's operating procedure and reserves. So I was wondering if you have looked at that and whether your results are related to theirs. And the second question is about the effects of monetary policy on the more broadly on the macroeconomy, whether you have looked at that and whether your approach can tell us something different from what we know. Thank you.
Well, let me take it right away. And unfortunately, I will give a very disappointing answer, I'm afraid. So I reveal my ignorance. I don't know the paper by Bernanke and Miko, so I can tell you our results compared to theirs. And I should definitely read it. So we will do that. Now, regarding the second question, we haven't looked at effects on the real economy. I think that, so in terms of procedure, it may be that the same methodology could be applied also to the transmission monetary policy to the real economy. Of course, there's a question of how fast your output variable, whatever variable you have in mind, your dependent variable, is going to respond to these shocks. So while it can happen relatively fast for rates, I'm not sure whether the same scale for Fed funds rates and the market reserves, I'm not sure whether the same scale, time scale, would be reasonable for other variables such as employment or growth. But I do think that there is an open route here, or an open question, if you want, which is whether we can try to repeat the same exercise in a more of a macroeconomic. That's good. So thank you, and thank you for the reference to the Mantis and Paul's paper. We will read it. And I'm sorry I can't give you a better answer.
Okay. Any other questions? Not in the chat. So maybe I can go ahead with my question. You stress in the paper in your presentation that you can use your model in a real time fashion. Let's say. So my simple question is, what will be the implication for the implementation of monetary policy when the policymaker look at this model in real time? So the policymaker can learn from this model today in order to influence in some way the decision on the implementation of monetary policy.
So This is a wonderful question, and I see my friend and co-author Gara here, so I would also like her to chime in. So my take is that, so I haven't shown you because I thought I wouldn't have time, but for example, I showed you the elasticity in sample. If you plot the elasticity estimated out of sample on our model, it's very similar, the line very well together. So the first thing you can do, you can just implement this out of sample estimation of the elasticity every day, and you can get a sense or whether this sensitivity of rates is turning to be negative in a significant way today or tomorrow, and so on and so forth. And you do it in real time. And then that may tell you that you don't want to be there and you want to just expand reserves just a bit to make sure that rates don't increase. So you can use the out of sample, so real time form of estimate of the elasticity of rates to reserve shocks to position yourself in the reserve supply. Now, an even more important thing, but it's a sort of a holy grail, and we're still working on it. So it's the next step of what we're trying to do, but it's very complicated to implement, is to use this model to understand, even when you're far away from when rates start becoming negative, where that point is, where the transition occurs. So our estimation so far, when you look at normalized reserves, showed you that the point seems to be roughly stable, but that roughly stable in terms of 12% of banks dollar assets, in terms of dollar value, is very different. Okay. And it's not written in stone that will be stable tomorrow. So conceptually, you would really like to know, wherever you are on the curve, where the king, let's say, using the old theory terminology, where the king is, because that's where reserves start, shocks in reserves start having a material effect on rates. And that's conflict a bit with the way we administer monetary policy now. It makes it a bit harder because now we use administer rates. So we don't want shocks in reserves to have too big of an effect on rates. So you want to make sure when you implement monetary policy that you are sufficiently away. Now, at the moment, our model tells you in real time what the elasticity is, which is already something, because as soon as it starts being negative, it's a warning signal. Ideally, but it's a very complicated thing to do because you need to bring back the nonlinearity. You would like to have a real-time estimate of your distance from where the curve starts being slow. Okay? And I will stop here because I think Gara is more experienced and more knowledgeable and may have something even more important to add. Like to Shamini.
Gabriel, I think you're doing perfectly fine. I think the question, I mean, this is a key question for monetary policy this day. We have transitioned for a system that was very different, where the central bank actively managed implementation by adjusting the supply of reserves, to a system where in the United States, the Federal Reserve have decided to remain in an environment of ample reserves, in an environment where the main tool is no longer adjusting the supply, but we like to influence where the rates are trading by affecting the outside options of the participants. So this system has a lot of advantages. One key element is how to understand where you are in that region of abundance, or as you reduce the size of the balance sheet, when you get close to a place where changes in the amount of reserves affect the price. So in some way, our model will give us a framework to think and understand how we are approaching that level where the amount of reserve is such that a small shift may affect the price, the level of the price of reserves, the rates. And that position is actually a very challenging question because it changes over time, which is part of why our sophisticated approach, it will be very, very helpful.
Okay, thank you very much.
So let me add something, since I know there is a panel on macroeconomics and STARS tomorrow, I believe. In a sense, you could think of the level which this demand curve starts being a significantly negative slope, right? As a B star, where B stands for whatever, reserve balances. Okay. So that's a quantity that if you want to implement monetary policy in a floor system through administered rates, you have to keep track of over time. Because as soon as you get close to that quantity, then your job may become more difficult. Okay? So I think that's a funding considerations, considering that the conference will just have a panel on star quantities in macroeconomics.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much for all these exhaustive answers to our questions. Any other questions from the audience?
Yes, there's a good question by Joao.
Yeah, very long.
Yeah, who's asking Joao, you want to ask me the question directly or should I rephrase it or just answer right away? So he's asking whether, so first of all, he's asking whether we exclude specific dates from our data to clean the data from possible endogeneity issues. And the answer is yes and no, in the sense that we remove 1 day windows around month ends. We have robustness with 2-day windows, it doesn't change. But we do not remove any day that has tax payments or treasury settlements. Those are still in. And then the second part of the question is whether removing some days would affect the real time properties of the model. And the short answer is, in a sense, yes, again. Because of course you don't have the model, you don't have an estimate for that day. And no, though, at the same time, because the only days that we're excluding are month ends, and we already have a sense from separate analysis of what's going to happen there. So in a sense, for the sake of what we're trying to do, we can just, in a sense, forget about it. That's my intuition. I don't know whether Gara or even Domenico have a different view about it, but say that I drop this 3 days around, 2 days around the end of a month, my model would not give me any number those days. I already know what will happen in the Fed funds market and how rates will change from a separate model. And then when we start over the next month, I just use the same machine. So intuitively, I don't think that it's a problem. If the question is whether if I include month ends, I get the same number, the answer is absolutely not, because actually the month-end effect due to the window dressing of European banks is extremely sizable. So are very massive fluctuations in the rate and massive fluctuation in reserves level due to overnight RRP usage. So if you include them and you run a simple regression, including those days, simple LS, then you will be in big trouble. So it's very important to take care of.
Thank you, Simon, for the introduction. And let me, before starting, thank the organizer for accepting our paper. It's not the first time we present the paper, but it's certainly one of the first times. It's the second time that we present this paper. So I would say that if possible, and if you have any comments on the presentation, also while I'm presenting, please feel free to let me know. So this is a joint work with Donato Masciandaro and Gaia Rubera from Bocconi University, in which we look at how monetary policy and financial markets react and how Twitter users can eventually tell us something more about monetary policy surprises. And so just to start as a motivation for this paper, we know that, and probably this will be no news for this audience, but we know that the outcome of central banks meeting drive financial markets, both in terms of returns, but also volatility, and that an increasing number of central banks use their institutional Twitter account to communicate their monetary policy decision. On top of this, we know that market participants closely monitor every single detail. If I remember well, at one point, there was even the Financial Times who was trying to understand the hawkish and dovish attitude of the various governor of central banks based on the color of their tie, on how their note was made. Well, and so as a consequence, we can expect that certainly markets participants will also start following Twitter users and tweets about monetary policy. So in terms of key research question for this paper, we want to actually test whether our Twitter-based measure of monetary policy surprise is somehow aligned with bonds and stock market reactions, both in terms of volatility and returns. But the first question here that might come to your mind is how often people tweet about monetary policy during monetary policy announcement day. So this graph is probably the first and most important motivation for our paper, where if you look at this graph, you will have in here that this graph captured the total number of tweets on monetary policy related messages in the 48 hours prior to a monetary policy announcement up until the 47 hours after a monetary policy announcement. So when we look at this graph, we can see that while most of the communication on monetary policy, at least the one that we capture in our database, is takes place in the hour prior of a monetary policy announcement and in the hour of a monetary policy announcement. But clearly, what we know so far is that by looking at the extensive existing literature on how central bank communication interacts with financial market, we know from the seminal paper from Gurkainak that, for example, and co-authors, that, for example, central bank communication has important effects on the reaction of asset prices and in particular government bonds. But this effect is diverse in the sense that the effect of monetary policy communication will be stronger on asset and bonds treasuries characterized by a longer maturity. So similar results, so this paper was first based on the US stock market reaction to monetary policy, but in recent years there has been an increase in the number of papers which studies, for example, in the case of the European Central Bank, or in the case of the Czeslak and Shrin paper, focus on the market reaction for announcements by the Fed, the Bank of England, the Bank of Japan, and the European Central Bank. However, our paper does not only relate to the literature on central bank communication per se, it also refers to the part of textual analysis, and in particular, the textual similarity. In this context, we know that one of the first papers who tries to assess the textual similarity of an announcement made by the Federal Open Market Committee is the Acosta and Mead paper from 2015, where they try to study how the different monetary policy announcements by the Fed differ over time. And in there, and by simply computing a measure of similarity between the different statements. And what they conclude is that basically, especially after the global financial crisis, these statements, they become more and more similar. So the part of the text which varies is rather limited. As an example, you can go now on any kind of newspaper, for example, on Bloomberg or the Wall Street Journal, and you can actually see how, for example, with a simulation, how the different speeches or announcement by the FOMC differ from one quarter to another or from one meeting to another. Similar results were found for the ECB and also more recently with the paper from Herman and Talmy on the case of the Bank of Canada. Well, they show in this case is one of the first paper which look at central bank communication and stock market reaction and textual similarity, and they study how the stock market react to larger changes in the similarity in the statement made by Bank of Canada. However, when we look at the literature, so our paper, we consider that it fits in the literature broadly on central bank communication and monetary policy surprises, but also the one on textual similarity, and finally the one on user tweeted by Twitter. So if we look at this literature, there are very few papers which have studied, for example, so far with a qualitative analysis, how central banks communicate their monetary policy decision, whether they have a clear or unclear communication style, whether they study the complexity of the text used in the Twitters, but in Twitter's messages, but little is known so far about how normal individual or Twitter users tweets about the monetary policy decision communicated by the central bank. One thing that is we know for sure is that central bank communication matters for both financial market returns and volatility. So what do we do in this paper? So we first create a database on the tweets about monetary policy communication for the three major central banks, which are the European Central Bank, the Federal Reserve Bank, and the Bank of England. Then we use Twitter messages to capture discussion on these central banks, especially capture discussion around the monetary policy announcement days. We then select all the discussions which closely relate to monetary policy announcement. So once we are able to pin down the tweets which closely refer to monetary policy announcement, we then measure the similarity between the tweets on monetary policy and the central bank communication. For example, if today the ECB releases a statement or has a press conference, we should expect that all the tweets which are made around the announcement will have a given similarity, which can be computed easily between the tweet, the text of the tweets, and the monetary policy communication by the central bank. This allows us to build an hourly measure of similarity between the tweets and central bank monetary policy decision. Next, once we have this measure of similarity, we assume that this measure can be proxied or considered as a decent proxy for monetary policy surprise. And so we use this variable to investigate the effect of changes in similarity that we consider our measure of surprise on market volatility and return. So just to give you an idea of what we find, we find that our Twitter-based measure or Twitter-based measure of monetary policy surprise conveys meaningful high-frequency signal on monetary policy surprises. And in particular, we find that larger dissimilarities between tweets are associated with higher asset prices volatility, following mainly the ECB and the Bank of England monetary policy announcement. Just to tell you that what we find is that the larger is the similarity between the tweets and the monetary policy communication, and the larger is the change in similarity before the hour of an announcement and in the hour of the announcement, the more a stock market reacts, both in terms of higher volatility, and I will show you some results of also for absolute returns. However, we find that while the results are confirming our idea for the ECB and the Fed, we find little evidence at the moment for the Bank of England. Why do we think that this paper can be useful? Is we consider it useful for not only for adding a new ideas on how monetary policy communication works in with social media and how this is interacted with social media traffic, but it also we suggest also a procedure that could be implemented for other countries as well. And on top of this, in a spillover paper, which could be we are planning to do, is we could actually use this procedure to study the role of non-expert market sentiment in explaining financial market reaction to monetary policy announcement. But so let me give you now some idea on how we collect the data and which is the empirical approach that we use in this paper. So the first thing we need to do is we needed to work on creating first a database on tweets and second on monetary policy announcement. So we start with the more complicated one because this really implied various steps in the analysis. So the first thing to do to collect tweets was actually to define a set of keywords which could be used to then download and extract the tweets related to eventually this set of keywords. So our data samples is obtained by extracting the tweets written in English and containing the following keywords. For the ECB, Fed, and Bank of England, the first set of keywords was represented by the Twitter ID number or user ID for these central banks. Then the second set of keywords was represented by the nickname or the name associated to this central bank. And lastly, you will see that what we'll have, there can be at times, especially when the central bank governor is more popular than the Twitter account of the central bank, as it is today the case of Christine Lagarde, which has more followers than the ECB official Twitter account. We'll have that typically monetary policy announcements are also depicted by simply citing with an hashtag the central bank governor. For those of you that are familiar with the Bank of England, you'd probably see that here there is clearly Mervyn King missing from the picture, but simply because we needed to have a really precise measure of tweets related to monetary policy. And so you can imagine that adding King to an extraction of tweets will only add noise and will make the capturing of actual tweets related to monetary policy more and more difficult. So after this first set of extraction, we were actually able to collect an overall sample of roughly 2,500,000 tweets, which were made between January 2011 and February 2020. We wanted to exclude on purpose the post-pandemic or the beginning of the pandemic, and that's why we stopped our analysis in 2020. Out of these 2.5 million tweets, we had that roughly 470,000 were released or were generated in the 2 days prior and 2 days post-monetary policy decision. So just to give you an idea a little more about what we faced while starting looking at this data, the first thing is that probably if we are trying to play here a game on try to find an excluder, you will see something that is in the pictures that we have in here. We have the three central banks of our study, but then we also find another outlier that is in this case is the England and Wales Cricket Board, which has the same starting part and starting name of the ECB. It has more followers than the ECB, and we realized immediately, yes, it was for us a learning process that there was lots of noise about this monetary policy or these tweets that we had extracted related to monetary policy. Another thing I want to say here is that if you think about the period of our analysis, why do we start in January 2011 is because all of these central banks created their accounts in 2009, and the tweets by these central banks started actually to pick up starting from 2011. But as I was mentioning before, when we were thinking about the tweets that are associated to the Twitter accounts that we refer to, or are citing these Twitter accounts that we are referring to, it comes to your mind and also to our mind, the idea of, first of all, distinguishing whether we are capturing true tweets about monetary policy or other things. For example, if you type the Federal Reserve Bank on Twitter, you will find that nowadays there will be more popular tweets on why not to buy cryptocurrency rather than effective monetary policy. So the second exercise that we did as a second step on our analysis after downloading all these tweets was actually to train a machine learning algorithm to classify relevant versus non-relevant tweets, right? As an example of relevant tweets that we were looking for example, that is in our database, is this example of a tweet that was made by this Mauro trader on a day of a monetary policy announcement day, where the ECB governor at the time, president at this time, Mario Draghi, said that the euro was irreversible. Another example in this case of relevant, even if not referred closely to a day of an announcement of monetary policy by the Federal Reserve, is a mention on the fact that the Chicago Fed president, Evans, mentioned that the Fed could look at rate hikes. However, in the pool, we had also a large amount of non-relevant tweets. If you remember before the England and Wales Cricket Board, we see here that while discussing clearly this England and Cricket Twitter cricket board, England and Wales cricket board, we have that someone mentioned the ECB and not the ECB cricket, but then talk about the Asian cricket communities. Another example of non-relevant tweets, which will happen a lot, is where are those referred to pure cryptocurrencies. And so in this case, we will have that Martin, this is an example of another tweet that we consider not relevant, that is a Mark Carney course for a crackdown on cryptocurrency mania. So what we do using all these entire 2.5 million of tweets, we actually train a machine learning. So we had randomly extracted 3,000 tweets out of these 2,500,000. We had two arrays working independently, tried to classify manually whether the tweets were relevant or not relevant for monetary policy. And then ourselves, we also coded the relevance or non-relevance of these tweets. And when there was full agreement on the fact that the tweets that we were coding and looking at were related to monetary policy, then we will have a dummy of equal to 1. 0 for those that were not relevant. Therefore, the machine learning algorithm learned how to actually distinguish between relevant and non-relevant tweets. This allows us to trim down our sample. Remember, we had roughly 470,000 tweets with the final sample of tweets that we consider related to monetary policy were roughly 230,000 tweets. In terms of frequency, we see that the number of tweets by the ECB and the Fed, they are roughly the same. They have in the most common days in which users around monetary policy announcements in which there are more tweets, we'll have roughly 7,000 tweets in the 2 days around the monetary policy announcement. But we see when we look at the Bank of England, we have very fewer tweets in the 2 days around a monetary policy announcement. So we'll have also lower value in terms of maximum number of tweets and the minimum number as well. In terms of monetary policy announcements, by looking at this this sample, we focus for the case of the ECB, we focus on the both the press release and the press conference. So the press release of the ECB takes place at 1:45 Central European Time, and the press conference starts at 2:30 and finishes at 3:30. Regarding the Fed, please, I mentioned here that the Fed press release, so the press statement of every FOMC will be made available at 2 p.m., especially between 2011 and 2012. We have certain cases in which this announcement takes place between 12:30 and 1:15, sorry, and 2:15. But in any case, we have taken this information into account. Let me generalize that I will consider for the Fed the press release to be released at 2 East Europe East time. And for the Bank of England, we have more episodes of central bank press releases, and they are all made available at 12. Regarding how do we deal with this full set of tweets and monetary policy announcement, what we basically do is actually computing similarity between central bank press releases, P, and tweets on monetary policy, M, at our age on the D. So this is an example of a press release made by the European Central Bank on the 6th of September, 2012. As you can see, the text was, the press release was really short text, and all the reference to the actual policies was sent during, was an invitation to join the press conference. So what we do is, when we compute the similarity, we look at this similarity between the press release and the entire corpus of tweets, which are released in every hour buckets before certain hours before a monetary policy announcement, at the monetary policy announcement, and hours afterwards. For example, what we have in this case is that for this policy announcement, what I will focus in discussing the result is mainly focusing on showing you how the similarities varies in the 8 hours before this announcement and the one afterwards. So just to give you an idea on how this similarity work. So when we compute this hourly similarity between the text of all the tweets on that specific hour and the actual monetary policy announcement that is made available at hour zero, in this case, the references to the press releases. What we can see in this case is that, for example, when we look at the situation, the two examples for the ECB, we have in this case that the similarity measure appears more stable and less volatile than what we have for the Fed and the Bank of England, right? These two policies or these two events characterize, in the first case, the official announcement of the OMT that was already preceded by the famous "Whatever It Takes" by Mario Draghi. So there was no much surprise when we look at the volatility of this similarity index. While in this case, we can see if we look at this in this gray area that is captures information on the variation in the level of similarity in the hour before the announcement and in the hour of an announcement of the monetary policy, we see here that there is a larger variation. In this case, the variation is the one that took place on the day in which the ECB announced the QE for the ECB, so the asset purchase program. When we look at the Fed, in this case, we have the example of a much more volatile similarity for the announcement of the tapering and the first increase in the key policy rate since 2009. Same was true for the Bank of England. In this case, we have an increase in similarity when the Bank of England decreased the key policy rates following the Brexit referendum. And afterwards, we have another example of a policy in which the governor of the Bank of England announced a possible increase in the key policy rate, which was not anticipated by the market. So, having in mind that we were able to compute this this measure of similarity at an hour frequency, and bear with me the fact that all the results that will be presented here will focus on the change in similarity in the hour prior of an announcement of monetary policy and the hour of the announcement, so the 60 minutes after an announcement of monetary policy, what we need to do next is actually try to see how this measure of similarity correlates with asset prices in terms of asset price volatility and return. So in terms of asset prices for the ECB, we were able to look at to capture high frequency data. So we had 1 minute frequency data on the major stock market indexes for the four major euro area countries, together with the stocks 50 index and the similar one for banks. And then we also had high frequency data on bond prices at maturity that varies from 1 year up to 30 years. For the US, we have the major stock market indexes and the treasury bills. We have the prices of the treasury bills. Unfortunately, we were not able to obtain the futures as they are used in other literature. This is we are still working on getting this data, but for what I will present to you today are these data on the actual value of the treasury bills and then the associated return and volatility. For the Bank of England, we had the FTSE 100, the stock market index, and we had the bond prices at different maturities, also in this case from 1 year to 30 years. So in terms of methodology, we use actually high frequency intraday data to test whether changes in the absolute similarity can explain asset price volatility. So let me stress that in this case, we were somehow agnostic about how the similarity could work. And to a certain extent, we don't have any prior on whether any increase in similarity or a decrease in similarity between the tweets and monetary policy announcement will create any value added. For example, if someone was expecting any increase in the key policy rate and the ECB, for example, doesn't increase the key policy rate, we might have that a Twitter user might be really disappointed and saying, well, I'm really disappointed. I was expecting the ECB to decrease or change monetary policy rather than leaving monetary policy unchanged. And so what we care here is try to look at the absolute change in similarity rather than the actual level of the change in similarity. And our interpretation in this case is that what we care is about the magnitude of the variation rather than the direction of this changing in similarity. And in terms of fast market volatility, we compute the realized variance of the returns. So we compute the sum of the square returns at a 1 minute frequency over the time of the monetary policy announcement that we consider. In our case, we look at the realized variance that goes from 15 minutes before a monetary policy announcement up to 15 minutes after a monetary policy event. The measure of similarity is the one that I described to you before. And we also control, fully aware of the fact that there was some variation in the number of Twitter made. And so the frequency of tweets about monetary policy increased exponentially in more recent years. And on top of this, we know that we also want to absorb some common time variation in asset prices reaction to monetary policy announcement. We also have in all our regression, even if I will not present these estimates, the year fixed effects to control for not only the time trend in Twitter usage, but also for absorbing this time variation in asset prices and how they react to monetary policy announcement. Just to give you an idea, with the case of the ECB, when we look at the realized variance, so we know that the press release is made at 1:45, and so we look at the realized variance, so the sum of the square return from 1:30 up to 2 for the press release, while for the press conference, we look at the period. We know that the press conference of the ECB starts at 2:30, finishes at 3:30. Central European time, and so we look at the entire horizon that goes from 2:15 up to 3:45. In this case, we will have also different periods of the realized variance. But this is actually, and what we will do, the same approach for the case of the Fed and the Bank of England. The only thing that will change here will be the timing of this announcement, but the horizon in the baseline setting I will present to you today are 15 minutes before and 15 minutes after an announcement. In terms of results, when we look at the comparison, so the dependent variable in this case is the realized variance, realized volatility, and explained by the absolute change in similarity. What we find here is that we find very or no evidence at all of any correlation between market volatility and absolute change in similarity while during the press release. While if we look at the press conference, so the horizon of the realized variance for the period that goes from 15 minutes before the ECB press conference and the 15 minutes after the end of the press conference, we find strongly and statistically significant results. They are positive, and this indicates that we find an association between the absolute change in similarity and stock market reaction during the ECB press conference window. When we look at how the markets react in terms of volatility to changes in similarity for the Fed and the Bank of England, you see that the coefficient estimates, they are less precisely estimated. They are statistically significant at 10%, but we still find that this absolute change in similarity, so the magnitude of our Twitter-based measure of monetary policy surprise, is associated with stock market volatility. If we move on now to how the bonds market reacts, and remember that the Gurnayak paper and co-authors suggested that there is an important effect of central bank communication on asset prices. They were focusing mainly on return, but in our case, we try to look at whether there is the same thing in terms of bonds volatility. And especially this relationship was becoming stronger when we looked at long the horizon. What we can see here is that at the bottom, you will have the coefficient estimates for the French, in this case, is the French bonds at maturity that ranges from 1 year to 30 years. You see that there is no statistically significant coefficient for our measure of the volatility of the different bonds and the coefficient estimates for the absolute change in similarity. While when we look at the press conference, what we see is that the effects becomes positive or at least statistically significant starting from bonds with a maturity of 5 years, and then it increases with reaching the maximum value of the coefficient estimates when we look at bonds with a maturity of more than with the maturity of 30 years. Is this the case for all euro area countries? Well, if we look at these examples, we see that for Germany, apart excluding this example in which during a press release we have a strongly statistically significant relationship between bond market volatility and the change in similarity, we see that if we focus on the press conference window, we find that there is a strong association between what we have as our Twitter-based measure of monetary policy surprise and bonds market volatility. The same holds true for all countries in the euro area, so at least the one in our sample, Italy and Spain as well. What happens to the case of the bonds for the Fed and the Bank of England? Well, in the case of the Bank of England, we actually find that there is no correlation between our Twitter-based measure of monetary policy surprise and the bonds market volatility. While for the US, we have that these results are weakly statistically significant at 10%, only when we look at treasuries with a maturity of 5 and 10 years. But so far, I have provided to you an idea about how asset prices volatility changes and how this is related to our measure of monetary policy surprise. So now I will borrow a graph I correctly cited here from a figure that is taken from Altavilla and co-authors, in which they actually look at, rather than focusing on asset prices volatility, they look at asset returns. So in this case, what they do is rather than looking at the realized variance, they look at the returns. And in order to identify the returns, they first look at the change in the asset prices between the post-release window and the pre-release window. In their case, they also look at, as we do, the median value. So they look at over this horizon for the pre-release window, they look at the median value of these asset prices just to get rid of some noisy in the pre-release window and post-release window. And they do the same for the pre-conference and post-conference window. I will show you now what we find in terms of stock markets returns. And just a caveat in here, remember that in our case, we were somehow agnostic about how similarity changes, positive or negative changes in similarity will affect stock market volatility. And so we are also agnostic about, since we don't have at the moment any measure on this eventually what we could call a positive or negative variation in similarity, in terms of sentiments and how people tweet about this monetary policy announcement, we assume a more standalone approach. And rather than looking at the actual return, we look at the absolute return. So we explain our absolute return. So we look at the variation of the stock market in absolute terms, so in terms of returns, explained by our time fixed effect and our Twitter-based measure, the absolute value of our Twitter-based measure of monetary policy surprise. And so what we find here is that for when we look at the results for bond stock market, we don't find much information. It seems that even if stock markets react to monetary policy, and especially this monetary policy surprise, by becoming more volatile, there is no association in terms of returns. This could also be somehow related to the information associated to monetary policy shocks, which can be temporary, especially for the stock market, but maybe it might be more persistent when we look at bond prices. And if this is the case, well, we test then whether there is an association between the absolute return and our Twitter-based measure of monetary policy surprise. So in this case, I'll show you again the coefficient estimates for our measure of monetary policy surprise, so the absolute change in similarity at different maturities for the French bonds. And so what we see is that we find a similar pattern with regard to what we have found for the realized volatility. We see that in this case, the further we go away from bonds with a shorter maturity, and so we adopt longer maturity for these bonds, we'll also have typically a larger stock market reaction to monetary policy announcement. Same evidence also, I know that I'm concerned about time, so that same evidence is found when we look at other euro area countries in our sample, so same Germany, Italy, Spain. And just to conclude, as a matter of time, as I will appreciate as many questions as possible, what we do in the rest of the paper, we also run the robustness looking at US and UK stock market indexes and bonds in terms of returns. The result in those cases, they are not they do not show any evidence of correlation between our measure of Twitter-based monetary policy surprise and returns. We look at different horizon and we focus also on the effect of only the introductory statement of the ECB versus during the press conference versus the entire press conference. So just to conclude, in our paper, we create a new measure of tweets about monetary policy for the ECB, the Bank of England and the Fed. We measure similarity between tweets on monetary policy and central bank press releases. And we provide evidence that large variation in similarity around monetary policy press releases are associated with spikes in volatility, in particular during ECB press conferences. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Very interesting presentation. We've got quite a few questions that have been coming up in the chat. I think I'll ask Angelica to ask her question. Angelica, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
Please go ahead.
Yes, I was just wondering if it's possible to provide a little bit more information on how precisely you did the estimates of the similarity between, or quantifying the similarity between the central bank press releases and the tweets, because it seemed that that was kind of a fundamental part of all of the work that followed.
Yeah, so, sorry, you want to understand how precise is the information or?
Well, I just wondered if you could provide a little bit more detail about the method that you use to measure the absolute similarity between the central bank press releases and the tweets that you collected.
Okay, yeah, so we use a standard, can you hear me?
Yes, yeah.
Yeah, we use the standard measure of similarity. And so in terms of how we implement it, basically just to say as a caveat, our first objective was to compute the similarity between every single tweet and press release, which was revealed to be impossible to estimate. And so we aggregated them. So we basically created, we had on one side the entire corpus of text associated to a press release of a given date, and the entire set of tweets on a given hour. And then we use Python basically to run this, compute this similarity measure between the corpus of tweets and the corpus of text associated to any specific monetary policy announcement.
Okay. Okay.
Okay, thanks. Let's move on to the next question. There's quite a few. Magali Marx. Magali, are you there? Would you like to ask your question?
Yes, yes, I am here. Thank you. I was wondering how we should interpret this elasticity that you estimate. Okay.
So how we, well, as I said, for the time being, we are somehow agnostic about how to interpret the magnitude, because the coefficient will vary a lot depending on also on the horizon, right? So for example, so the realized volatility will change a lot when you look, for example, at a shorter period of time versus the press conference. In our case, we didn't want to enter too much into detail on how we compare and what kind of asset price variation will be associated to a change in similarity. So for the time being, we only focus on the coefficient and whether this coefficient remains statistically significant. Our indication of a good idea of how precisely estimated our coefficient were that to a certain extent, the reaction, especially for longer maturity, was in line with what we will expect, that monetary policy surprises or monetary policy will affect mostly bonds with longer maturities. And so our results, at least for the coefficient, for the magnitude of the coefficient, are pointing towards the right idea, that we had in mind that the volatility is basically higher when there is more surprise. But yes. Yeah, certainly as a follow-up, we will be aiming at providing more detailed information on how changes in similarity would reflect to variation in basis points, for example.
Yes, exactly. That was what I had in mind. Thank you. Indeed, it was a sort of quantification of, based on your Twitter.
Yeah. So to be honest, at the moment we didn't quantify this, but we are actually working on revising the working paper, and so this is certainly something that we will add to the paper.
Thank you.
Okay, quite a few more questions still coming in. Let me toss it to Barbara Rossi. Barbara, if you're there, you've got a double-barreled question, I think.
Thank you, Simon. And Davide, I was wondering if you looked at the correlation between your similarity index and the traditional, say, monetary policy surprise a la Gurkhaynak. I wonder whether it would be useful to figure out whether it's more correlated with their target factor or their path factor, or if there is any correlation at all. And then the second thought I had, you know, you use the absolute value of your index, and I was wondering if there is any information in the sign, and this could be done just by adding a dummy. Thank you.
Thanks, Amelia. So the correlation between our measure and the Gurkhaynak and co-authors is in our to-do list, because actually what's the paper that we have submitted that only data on the volatility and not on returns. But certainly this is one thing that we are aiming to do in the coming weeks. And it is true that when we look at the values, for the similarity, we could look eventually introducing a dummy for positive versus negative. Our approach for how we see the things that we want to implement to the paper, we're now trying to understand whether it would be possible to actually measure a sentiment analysis of those tweets, so that we also have the direction of whether the tweets they become more positive versus negative. But this will affect the entire re-estimation of all the tweets and extraction of the data. But probably a shortcut to this will be actually your very useful comment on introducing a dummy on the direction. Thank you.
Okay, there's lots more questions coming in the chat. I'm sure we won't have time to get through all of them, but maybe you'll want to respond to some of them after the session. Let's see if we still have time to get to one or two more. There's one from Richard Chu, who has a microphone that's not working and has asked me to read it. And he's really interested in the machine learning algorithm and its reliability So he's asking, how large is the training set that you used? What exactly is the machine learning algorithm? And how was its performance? I guess he's interested both training sample and out of sample. You mentioned a little bit on how you had an identified set. Could you just take a minute or two and amplify a bit on exactly what you did there?
Yeah, so regarding the training set that we believed that it was enough for us to have 3,000 tweets. So this is our trainings. So the set of tweets that we trained was equal to 3,000. And then when we tried to estimate how by classifying this, so by creating this this dummy and having a probit model able to capture how our own classification was correlated with the one by the machine, we reached an R square of close to 75%. So we were somehow confident that in 75% of the tweets that we had classified, we had a correct classification. Certainly it's not a correlation of or an R square of 99, but we were fairly happy about the confidence on how our machine learning algorithm was able to actually capture and select relevant tweets. Then I would be happy also to provide additional detail afterwards.
Okay, thank you very much. So I'll be continuing with the chain of Italian speakers today. And let me start by thanking the organizer to have accepted our paper and put together such an interesting program. What I present today is a working in progress project joined with Claudiana Istrefi and Florence Odendal, who are also today virtually with us. It is the first time we present this paper in a conference, so really don't hesitate later to give your reaction comments and also to interrupt me if you like for any clarification questions. So the topic of this paper is that of a long history of love and hate, which is the one between central banks and financial markets. We have seen also the paper of Davide that there is a large literature on how these two institutions, if we may call it like that, influence each other. I think it's quite interesting that this paper comes after the previous one that was really concentrated on communication and monetary policy shocks from a perspective of the day of the monetary policy announcement. So what we start with is the observation given in this chart that there is a considerable amount of communication that occurs outside of monetary policy meetings. And we want to really look into that for the ECB. And when I talk about other communication, you should think about speeches, parliament hearings, interviews, publication of accounts. So we count that in our database, we have on average over the 20 years of life of the ECB, around 185 communication outside monetary policy days, that's the acronyms we have here, per year compared to on average 12 governing council meetings. Per year. Now there are 8 since 2015, but they've been 12 for much of the life of the ECB, and in the early years there were more than 20. So here in the charts you have other form of communication. So you have speeches or communication from president of ECB in red, from the executive board, other members of the executive boards of the ECB in green, NCB governors, the main let's say the main countries of the euro area. So we took Banque de France, Bundesbank, Banca d'Italia, and Banco Spain. And then you see at the end of the sample, there are other communication events, like there are the publication of accounts that started in 2015, and also the creation of SSM. So we have speeches from the SSM chair. Of course, these two, given the little sample, they will be not exploited in the regression analysis later on, but still are part of our data set. So the motivation is that there is indeed a large literature that looks at impact of monetary policy news or surprises on financial markets, but they typically focus on movements around ECB Governing Council meeting. And what we are more in, what I'm interested in this paper is to look at what happened, what about communication outside of these monetary policy days. And for the ECB, there is also the observation that often expectation about monetary policy decision are formed ahead of Governing Council meetings. So we want to test is this communication outside monetary policy days a channel for updates of market beliefs about policy changes. So in a nutshell, the question that we want to address in this paper, there are three main questions for the moment. The first is whether this communication outside monetary policy days provide a systematic and consistent signal and move markets, which communication matters more, and how the effect of this communication compare with the regular effect from monetary policy announcements. Maybe I don't think I have to convince you of the fact that some public remarks are outside of the press conferences that we have seen in the previous paper receive a large coverage by media. Here we just took two examples, one from Trichet's speech in 2011 and one from a Draghi speech in 2015, where they basically sort of pre-announce the policy movement, or they give a strong signal. So in the first one, Bloomberg report that we are taking the decision progressively to anchor inflation expectation. And as far as we are concerned, we are in a strong vigilance mode. And Bloomberg report that the markets, in particularly FX, have changed immediately after the speech. And the second speech is one of Draghi in 2015, where he says that if we decide that the current trajectory of our policy is not sufficient to achieve that objective, meaning price stability, we will do what we must to raise inflation as quickly as possible. And the euro fell after this. That's just to motivate why we want to look at this kind of communication outside monetary policy days. We construct then an extensive data set of this communication, ECB Eurosystem communication events, and we match these events to movements daily and intradaily of more than 60 euro area financial variables to study the importance of communication events on the markets. And we want to stress that really we plan to make this database of communication events outside meeting days of financial surprises or news available for researchers once we are 100% sure about the database. The preview of results so far is that using an even study on daily data on the entire life of the ECB, okay, we stopped in 2019, we find that this communication out of monetary policy days has a statistic and economic effect on some economic variables, in particular on Eonia OIS rates, ELS-based inflation expectation, and some sovereign bond rates. And it's a communication by ECB president that shows the strongest and most systematic effect, especially after the great financial crisis. And we also find that president's communication before policy changes, so before days where there are announcement of policy changes, move Eonia rates in the same direction as the upcoming policy change. And if I will have time at the end, I will talk briefly about work in progress of different avenues of research of this paper or maybe other projects as well. So looking more at the content of news, then there is also our willingness to try to also give some insight on the literature between news versus rate shocks, comparing Governing Council meetings versus this communication outside monetary policy days. And finally, we started to make a rigorous intraday data analysis that so far confirms that significant movements of Eonia rates are following this communication outside on monetary policy days. So we relate to different strands of the literature. Overall, we relate to the literature on the informational content of central bank communication that find a role of communication for movement in financial markets, both in meeting days. So there are many papers on the Fed and ECB, and also out of regular meeting days. There are less papers on that and on the signaling power of speeches for future policy, but we also relate to the literature that identify monetary policy shocks, and we'll go back to that later. And we will provide, as I said, a euro area communication event study database that will contain daily, intradaily changes on several financial variables around different communication events. So the data we compile, we have three data sets, two that we call events data set, one about communication, like we call it ECB events, and one about control variables. So the ECB events gives you the date, time, speaker, location, and often also the content of different communication events. So there are the usual ECB monetary policy decisions, so alla Alta Villa et al. Then there are like ECB president hearings at the European Parliament, monetary policy accounts, and communication events, scheduled communication events of ECB presidents, executive board members, SSM chairs, and governors of four main national central banks of the Eurosystem. Then we compile a data set of controls that gives you the time and the date of several control variables that are important to take into account. They are usual in the literature, so major macroeconomic releases for the euro area and the US, and we also include FOMC monetary policy decisions days. And at the end, we compile a financial market data set where we have financial variables for the euro area at both daily and minute by minute frequency. There are the usually, the key variables that are looked at in the literature. So mainly Eonia rates that for the euro area are proxy for the euro area yield curve, the let's say safe one, from 1 month to 20 years. The ELS, which are also like an object very much studied in the central banks for computing inflation expectation of, over different horizons. We have sovereign yields of the four main countries of the euro area, exchange rates, stock market indices, and the VIX. So the data comes, so the events data comes from Bloomberg. We spend a lot of time, and when I say a lot, it's a lot of time, cleaning for errors, duplicates, missed reports. And we could match some of these ECB events with the database of Alta Villa et al. For what concern governing council meetings and with the ECB speech database, because the ECB provides a speech database, but we have many more communication events that in this speech database. But the nice thing about the ECB database is that contains the text. So for future text analysis, it could be useful. And the financial market data come from Bloomberg for the daily data and from Thomson Reuters Econ for the minute by minute. And here it's just a summary table where you have an idea of the sample of the different communication events, the source, and the number of observations that we have in our database. Before going into regressions analysis, I'd like just to give you some stylus facts. So to give you an idea of how this financial, what was the average change in basis point of a few of these financial variables over different days. So here I plot the OES 1 year for the full sample on the left and the post-crisis sample, so after 2008. So you see, maybe it's a bit small, but the red bar is the average, the mean absolute changes over all the governing council meetings days that we have in our sample. So on average, you don't see many difference between the two samples. So this variable tends to move more than the average, more than in a no event day, which is the black bar, during governing council meetings and also during some of the speaking events I was saying before, like for instance, president speeches. There are other variables where you see much bigger differences between that different sample, of course, like one is the sovereign spreads. Here you have the Italian versus Germany 10-year sovereign spreads for the pre-crisis and the post-crisis sample. And without, I mean, I think it's not very surprising that in the pre-crisis sample, there was no action at all in spreads. And instead, there is a lot of movement in spreads in the post-crisis sample, and especially during governing council meetings, and also a bit during presidential hearings. Of course, this is just an idea, stylized fact. We don't control for anything here. It's just to give you an idea on. And finally, you see another object which is very much of interest for central banks. We construct ELS, so inflation expectation medium term, 2 year on 2 year, and a long term, 5 year on 5 year. You have the sample is the post-crisis sample on the 2 years, 2 years on the left, 5 years, 5 years on the right. And you see that these objects tend to move quite a lot during governing council meetings and also president communication days. And I'll show you later some econometric results on that. So let me pass to the daily regression analysis, unless someone has any question. So what we do is that we want to understand if there is a systematic effect of this communication on the financial markets of interest. So the baseline regression takes the form of equation one. So we look at absolute values of financial variable of interest, and we regress on a constant, on a lagged value, and on our indicators of different communication events. So we have president speeches, board speeches, president hearings, NCB speeches, and then we have usual governing council days and a set of controls, the WT, which includes, as I said, Euro area and US macro release dates, but also we have day of the week dummy and month of the year dummy. So the results for the full sample are in this table. So what you see here, a lot of numbers you see, but let me explain. So you see that ECB governing council line, which is the effect on the ONIA and ELS in the basis point on average across the full sample, are significant. There is significant effect of on governing council days. And you see also significant effect on some maturities of EONIA and OELS in and on ELS expectation from president speeches, and not much action, actually nothing very much significant on different form of communication from president speeches. When we look maybe more interesting on the split between the pre and the post crisis, which correspond also to different sort of monetary policy measures and communication, because it's the introduction of unconventional monetary policy in the euro area. You see that on the lower panel, the ECB president speeches become significant across all the ONIA and ELS variable that we look at, but maybe there is no much significance on the 10-year, but on the rest. And instead, before the crisis, president communication doesn't seem to affect this financial variable much. Instead, board and NCB were more effective in driving changes in these variables before the crisis. So I show you just EONIA and ELS, but as I said, we have 60 financial variables. So here it's just to give you an idea of what we find overall for the full sample. So you can have results of this daily regression by type of communication on the rows and by type of financial variables on the first column. Overall, what we find is that ECB governing council days affect markets significantly and systematically, so all the financial variables. President speeches, they affect in a systematic way EONIA and French and German yields and ELS. And then we have some systematic effect of board and NCB, but less than the president effect, and no systematic effect of other forms of communication. Just some additional results on the daily frequency regression. They are robust to several sensitivity checks that we perform, like we exclude, like we try, for instance, excluding key ECB president speeches. We consider in the baseline only communication events on market trading hours, so between 9 a.m. and 5 p.m. And then we do robustness on how to consider communication that occurs outside trading hours. We also have regression where we include, or, I mean, in the baseline, we exclude communication on weekends, but the results are robust in including that and assigning to Monday, and also to ECB president fixed effects. So the results don't depend on just one president of the ECB communication. So as I show, like, these are very, it's average results across a long span of data. And we thought that these results are interesting, but of course may drive some key forces that, I mean, may mask some key driving forces. We've seen that already if we split the sample, you see different results, but it also could be that these average results depend on specific events. And what we wanted to check with just with the raw data, it was on governing council meetings day that we have seen are the most powerful days in influencing markets. If all governing council meetings are on average give the same impact on financial variables or not. So here what you see is that we kind of slice the data. So we have the ONIA 3 months on the left, ALS 2 year, 2 year on the right, and you see that the average effect on all governing council meetings is actually driven by what happened when there is a policy change. So that's also not surprising per se. So when the governing council announce a policy change, markets react much more than in other cases. And that per se, so it's interesting. And what we wanted to assess is whether this is true also for communication outside of monetary policy days. So what we look at is, we have seen before that president speeches are the most important, let's say, in driving our results. So we look also at the effect of president's speeches overall, which is the first bar on the same asset. So you have Aonia 3 months and ALS 2 years on 2 years, and which is the effect of these speeches that occurred before policy changes with respect to all the other speeches. And you see that there is much more action following in speeches before a policy change. And in the second part of the paper, now I will show you, that's what we want to test more formally. We want to understand how communication before meetings with policy changes affect financial markets. So to do that, we collect the dates of ECB monetary policy changes, including both conventional and unconventional measures. So overall, in our sample, we have 39 conventional measures, so conventional measure days announcement, and 24 non-conventional. Of course, some of those are the same because there've been instances in which the ECB announced both a change in the policy rate and an unconventional measure. We do not consider so far forex guidance changes, but we consider all the QE, liquidity provision measure, OMT, and other measures. And what we do is that we interact our communication outside of monetary policy days events with the period before a change in the policy stance. And we regress the daily changes of the financial variable on this interaction between our events, communication events, and the pre-policy change period. And of course, here we are interested in the daily change and not the absolute, because we are interested in the on the sign of the impact of these speeches. So the regression specification takes this form. So we construct an indicator variable equal to 1 in the period before policy changes, and we distinguish between future easing and future tightening. We consider like a period of, so this period before, it's half of the period between the meetings with the change and the previous meeting, which on average across the sample is around 3 weeks, okay? So we consider only communication on the 3 weeks before a policy change. And so you have the financial variable of interest, so the delta, the variation is financial value, the daily change, which it regresses again on itself lagged on a constant, and then it's regressed on our different communication events where ECBP is president, ECBB is board, PH is presidential hearings, NCB is NCB speeches. And then we interacted with this future easing or future tightening. So we put easing on in green and tightening in red. And we also consider what happened during governing council with easing decision and tightening decision. This is the alpha 2, alpha 3 coefficients. And finally, we have a coefficient gamma 1 or gamma 2 that measure the average daily change in the financial variable before these easing and tightening decisions. So I hope it's clear. Maybe with the table, I will try to explain because the table is very big. So I'll try to explain the table step by step. So the first two lines, future easing, future tightening, corresponds to gamma 1 and gamma 2 here. So what we see is that on average across the full sample, markets actually there is already a decrease in here is Eonia rates across all maturities in the 3 weeks before a real announcement of easing. And for tightening, that and that is, if you consider that on average is 15 days, it means that on average, Eonia rates decrease by 4 to 14 basis points in the 3 weeks before. And for future tightening, we find some evidence of already incorporating, market incorporating tightening for short-term maturities. That's also coherent with the fact that tightening decision in our sample occurred only before the sovereign debt crisis. So when monetary policy was conventional monetary policy, not unconventional, so with more effect on the short-term yields. The other block of results is from ECB governing council days. So you have the easing and tightening governing council. What you see here is then the coefficient alpha 2 and alpha 3 here. You see that ECB governing council with easing decision have an impact, significant impact on short-term yields from 1 month to 6 months. And ECB governing council tightening, you have only some impact on the very short maturities and no impact on the other maturities. That's a result which is, we think, quite interesting per se, and I will come back later on that, because often when you do identification monetary policy shock for tightening without considering other communication events, you don't find much. And that's exactly what we don't find much on the tightening. And in the easing, we find some effect. For the other block are our interaction coefficient of interest, where we interact the ECB president speeches with the future easing, future tightening, and the president hearings with future easing, future tightening. And what you see is that actually there is quite an interesting effect and significant effect of a presidential speech before an easing on the short-term maturities and of president hearings on the long-term. And for future tightening, you see quite a consistent and significant effect across all maturities from president speeches before this tightening. So I hope it was clear. it's a big table. Here, I will skip. It's basically what I just said before. And of course, here, just to be clear, we interact this with other forms of communication, but I reported here only things that are significant. So what we find significant is that president speeches may be a driving force of market updates of future policy changes. So I have I've been fast, so maybe I have 5 minutes for the work in progress. So there are different avenues we are trying to explore. The first is to look at the text of news. So on these president speeches before policy changes that we just show are significant, have a significant impact on the yield curve, we collect and read all the related Bloomberg news. And we were interested also in knowing how much time does the news make to arrive to markets, in a way. So we see that in majority of the cases, and more than 60% or roughly 60% of the events, the news arrive between 1.5 and 3 hours from the scheduled event time. So then there are some important speeches where the news comes really few minutes after, but on average it's between 1.5 and 3 hours. And we want to classify these 51 identified events of speeches of president before policy changes in those that have a clear, strong signal for the next policy move, and some which are weak signal, some that apparently don't have a signal, at least in the news that are reported by Bloomberg. Here again, it's just two examples of a tightening speech and an easing speech, let's call it like that. So speeches before an easing and a tightening. And we plan to assess more the content of the news and to understand how the signal events impact the market. So this is something we are doing at the moment. A second work in progress is to relate to the literature that identify. So there is a large literature, I'm sure you all know, that says that actually monetary policy surprise per se can identify, I mean, you can identify different shocks, at least two different shocks from a monetary policy surprise. A news on future macroeconomic conditions, so when the central bank decide to, let's say, decrease rates, it could have some private or superior information on the macroeconomic situation ahead. So, or it could be that it's a real monetary policy shocks about a future monetary policy stance. So I'm thinking here about the paper of Nakamura Stenson 2018 or Miranda Grippino Enrico 2021, just to give you an idea. So we thought that it could be interesting, following a bit the idea in Andrade and Ferroni, to study and compare how EONIA and ELS changes, EONIA rates and ELS changes on days of monetary policy decision, and also that's something that Andrade, Philippe, and Filippo do, but also on our communication outside of monetary policy days. So I give you just a first really rough example. It's not econometrics, it's just the data, what they show. So here you have on the right, you have monetary policy announcement days when there is an easing. And on the right, you have days where there is president speech in the pre-easing period. And then you see how ELS and OES change. And this scatter plot give you an idea of whether these changes are consistent more with news on the macroeconomic condition or news on the stance. And I put in the dots in blue are the one in the upper left quadrant that are consistent, let's say, with easing stance shocks. And the dots in the lower left quadrant would be more consistent with news shocks on the macroeconomic condition. So a bad, let's say, bad macroeconomic conditions, because you have that ELS decrease. So we are trying to dig more into that, and especially because, to our knowledge, there is no literature on this kind of news versus stance shocks with related to communication, which is not governing council meetings days and announcements. And finally, my last minutes, I would just say that we start performing an intraday analysis, because we have for each of our communication events, we have the time of the communication and the minute by minute quote. So we can compute surprises around a shorter time window than the daily window that we considered so far. So the Bloomberg News analysis that I showed you before and a subset of our communication events suggests that the news are typically reported within 1.5 and 3 hours after the event. So we took these to compute time windows for our communication events. So we take, it's a bit the same chart. I mean, I didn't do the chart that Davide showed before for Altavilla, but here is for speeches. We consider larger windows because it could make more time to the news to arrive to market. So we consider the median quote between 1.5 hour and 2.5 hours after the scheduled speech. The difference between the median quotes and the median quotes of the hour before the scheduled event. That's the way we compute the windows for non-governing council meeting announcement. Ideally, we want to confirm the daily results, so we want like to see that intraday movements around communication events are larger than outside events. But here there is a problem is that we cannot simply run regression like we did for the daily changes because the left-hand side variable, it's unclear. And we're not aware of any, so normally there is a lot of papers that use this very high frequency surprises and they identify monetary policy shocks in this way, but we're not aware of any paper that actually look at whether this is economically significant and statistically significant. So we want to perform that. So we want to compute average changes of our financial variables on non-event days within specific time windows, which are similar to the one to compute the surprises for our speaking events. And what we find that we show you now is that we find significant high frequency effect of our communication outside of monetary policy days. So how do we do? The goal is to compare high frequency changes around events to something like a typical intraday change of the same window length. So we, 5 minutes, I will be fast. We develop a simulation algorithm for non-event state that is like that. So we denote by capital D a set of non-event trading dates. I mean, I want to be sure that non-event here is non-event in our data set. It's not that there are no events. Of course, there are a lot of other events going on, but in our data set, there is no event. What we do is the following step. We draw n random days with replacement from this set of non-event trading days. Then we draw n random times with replacement that are within the trading hours. And then we compute the surprises for each of these n date time combination using the same window lengths as for the event surprises that we want to compare with. And so we compute this set of surprises and then we compute the mean or the quantiles of this because, I will show you that when, so here it's the table just for you to be more clear on that. So what you have is that the value in brackets show the 90% percentile of the simulated medians. Of these surprises. And then we put in bold when the median surprise of the absolute change in the financial variable of interest here at Ionia rates is larger than this 90% median of the simulated surprises. What you see is that for president speeches, but also for board speeches, most of these surprises are statistically significant, like with this simulation algorithm. So what you see here is that board also seems to influence board speech seems to influence markets more than with the daily analysis. So it looks like that maybe the influence is just very short-lived because we don't see much on the daily regression, but for presidents it's a confirmation of what we have already found. Just last slide, but I will not really comment on that, but when you pass from absolute daily changes to daily changes, because we plan to do the same for the exercise we did on the pre-policy meetings. You cannot really look at median or average, so you have to go into quantile, sort of quantile regressions, sort of quantile comparisons, where you see that you look at the instances where president speeches have impacted the most on the negative or positive sign Eonia rates, and you compute the same quantile from your simulated data, and again you see that for president speeches there seems to be often significant this impact on the daily on the intra-daily changes in the financial variable. Here we just have Eonia, it's a work in progress, but maybe we'll be happy to hear about what you think about this, trying to identify the statistical significance of these intraday changes and also the simulation argument that we did. So to conclude, we find a systematic effect of this communication outside of monetary policy days on markets, especially in on Eonia rates, ELS-based inflation expectations, sovereign bond rates. Most of the effect comes from president speeches, especially after 2008. This communication outside of monetary policy days, before policy changes, especially president's communication, seems to be a channel driving markets updates on future policy. So a possible implication of all this is that identifying monetary policy shocks only from asset price movements on governing currency days may be reductive or even difficult if a large fraction of market expectation about future policy are formed before the days of announcement. And I show you this the case, for instance, for all tightening decisions of the ECB up to 2011, which was the last tightening decisions. Thank you. I have finished.
Okay. Thank you very much, Julia. Perfectly on time. We're starting to get a couple of questions in the chat. Let me toss it to Magali Marx, who's got a question for you.
Hi, thanks a lot for the presentation, Julia. I had just a specific question because it seems to me that for the moment you just consider all the speeches by the board, for instance, with the same weight in your analysis, and I was wondering if it was possible with not so big cost just to refine the analysis by just focusing on topics which make more sense for monetary policy or this type of things. Thanks a lot.
Okay, that's exactly on our to-do list. Yeah. First, what we did is that at least we try with just chief economist speeches, because we thought the chief economists, they speak more about monetary policy and economics.
Thank you.
We didn't find any relevant results so far for chief economists. But another avenue is going to text analysis. That's something we do with Florence and Claudiana in another paper for the Fed. And indeed, it would be very interesting to just pick those speeches that have a high content on monetary policy. But we didn't do it yet.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. Happy to take more questions. I think I see Barbara Rossi coming in with a quick question and one or two others popping up. Barbara, why don't you go ahead?
Yes, thanks. Great data set, Julia. I was wondering if you could look at the effects of such speeches on other variables, for example, uncertainty. I wonder whether it would be curious, I know I would be curious to know whether they increase or decrease uncertainty, for example.
Yeah, okay. We haven't looked at uncertainty. The most similar thing to uncertainty is the VIX. And we don't find evidence of this this communication outside of monetary policy days having an impact on VIX, but maybe we could think about other uncertainty measures, volatility, for instance. We didn't do that. Volatility of asset prices, for instance.
Mm-hmm. Right, or an EPU index. So there are some indices that are also, I think, available on daily at the daily frequency.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, like the Bloom literature, yes.
Okay. Next question, I'll toss it to, and sorry for mangling your name, Jao Makalo, who has a question about predicting easing and tightening. Would you like to go ahead?
Thank you for the presentation. It was very interesting. I was wondering, because the future tightening or future easing of monetary policies are very important in your results, if you will attempt to predict these directions in real time, because in a sense we don't know when the president of the ECB makes a speech, if in the future it will lead to a future tightening or future easing. So it will be nice to have at least an attempt to use the text to predict this direction. So if you plan to go to do something in this direction. Thank you. Thank you again for the presentation.
Honestly, for the moment, we haven't planned this, but there is a paper, I think it's the Leombroni et al. Paper that we cite in the slides that do a bit this. I hope it's Claudiana, maybe knows more than me, but I think it's this paper, not that it does what you have in mind. So he look at speeches of ECB policymakers and look at whether it predicts policy changes. And if I remember well, it defined that this is the case. But we don't, for the moment, we don't plan to do on that forecasting of monetary policy changes.
Okay. Katovic had a question, but that was supposed to be private communication. So, okay, instead of throwing it to Katovic, I'll ask a question. Can you review for us, you put a lot of emphasis in the results that you've been showing us on statistical significance. Can you help us understand the relative economic significance of the effects that you're finding?
Sure. I didn't do that, it's true. Let me maybe have to show the slide again then.
That's my fault.
No, it's okay. I will do that. Just to give you an idea how to interpret the results.
Sure.
For instance, let's take this is the results for the full sample Eonia ELS. Let's take the 5-year Eonia rate. So,
okay.
The ECB Governing Council. This is basis points. Okay. So, if you are interested in how much different events impact these Eonia 5-year rates on a quarter, for instance, you know that there are 2 or 3 ECB Governing Council per quarter, depending on whether you are before and after 2015, let's say around three. So you have on average 5 basis point impact of Governing Council per quarter on the 5-year Eonia. We know, because we computed, that there are between 7 and 8 president speeches per quarter. So you would multiply this 0.4 by 7 or 8, it will give you around 3 basis point impact. Of course, as we said before, these are average that mask many different kind of speeches. And then going to the direction of what Magali was suggesting, it would be interesting to just clean a bit all the speeches and just look at the one that are relevant, that give signals. That's something we want to do, for instance, in our subset of speeches before policy changes. But to give you an economic this is our basis points, and then they are a bit higher. The of course, the movements during Governing Council meeting days, but the president's speeches also move markets in a significant way. As the rough charts that I show at the beginning also show. I mean, Governing Council always have a higher impact, which is also a bit reassuring.
Right. Okay. Any other questions? Any hands up?
Yeah, this is Matteo. I have a question. It's not really a question, it's just a curiosity about your data set. I was wondering whether the number of ECB president speeches has dramatically increased after the great financial crisis, and the also the you know the nature of the signal we can extrapolate from the speeches changed, because before the financial crisis, well, a little bit after the financial crisis, you could extract some signals about tightening of the monetary policy, whether thereafter the signal could be only towards the easing direction of the monetary policy. So I don't know if it's a curiosity, honestly, but I don't know if it could have an impact on the overall results you get from your analysis. And thank you.
Okay, first, I wouldn't say that president's speeches have increased dramatically after the crisis, because if you look at these charts, you see that they are roughly 30 per year. They have increased during the financial crisis, but otherwise there is no big increase. But you're right that for sure the sign of the direction of the signal is of course unidirectional since 10 years. And then I think it's also why we get these results for tightening, and so these results give you an idea that indeed easing speeches, they all, well, actually also future time. Okay, so maybe we could exploit more of this, but I don't have an answer on this point. But what we find is there is much signal also on the ECB president's speech before 2008 for future tightening. So maybe what we should do is to just have this on different subsamples, and what you will find is that possibly this line will be not significant anymore in the post-crisis for sure, because there are no tightening. So maybe we show like how this have changed over time.